may be seated. Oh, greet your neighbor in the name of the Lord this morning. What am I thinking? What am I doing? I'm thinking about what's next and not what's going on right now. Now you can be seated, and if you'll look on the back of your bulletins, as far as announcements go, I do have a few things to announce today. First of all, I need some help this coming weekend. Kids Count group, we do a Wednesday night thing, and the Baptist Church does a Wednesday night thing every week during the school year, and theirs is called Kids Count. Well, during Kids Count, they signed up about 30-something kids to go to church camp this summer. Well, they are needing help getting them there and back. And so a lot of the kids in our church are going along with them, and so I volunteered to help take kids down there on Wednesday to Camp Chaparral, which I think is up kind of around the Wichita Falls area. So we'll be taking our church bus to haul kids to camp, but then I'm going to be at my family reunion on Saturday, and that's when they get done with camp. And so I need a volunteer who wouldn't mind following the Baptist Church van up to Camp Chaparral on Saturday and picking up a load of kids and bringing them back to Throckmorton on Saturday. So if anyone would like to volunteer, you do not have to have a commercial driver's license to drive our bus. It is a 15-passenger bus, so anybody can do it. So if you'd like to volunteer to do that, catch me after church or contact me during the week and let me know. We would appreciate it. Also, August, I know it's hard to believe, but it's already our turn to feed the youth again. August is our month to feed the youth, and there are 5 Wednesdays in August. And so we need some volunteers to provide meals for the youth group beginning on August the 2nd. And so if anyone would like to volunteer to help out with meals, you can let me know. You can also let Amy Hale know. She's going to be helping me coordinate those. And so she's out of pocket for the next week or so, I think, out of town. So if you want to just text me or email me or catch me after church and say, hey, we'll take August 9th or we'll take August 2nd or whatever and provide meals for the youth during the month of August, we would appreciate that, any of the help that we can get there. Are there any other announcements that we need to lift up this morning? Okay, we're having a lunch for the teachers during their in-service on August the 14th, which is a Monday, so you may be getting a notice from some ladies to help bring food for that event on August the 14th here in the Fellowship Hall. Anything else? Okay, we're going to watch here in just a moment. We're going to watch a short video. This is something that one of the things that's neat about the Methodist system is that we are a connectional system. We support not only our own local congregation, but we support a district. We support a conference. They support us. We help each other in times of need. A lot of you may not realize, but back earlier in the summer or the spring in Anton, Texas. Anton is a little community about our size up around the Lubbock area. They suffered a severe hailstorm. We're talking baseball-sized hail falling over the entire city of Anton for up to about 20 minutes. Every single building in the city of Anton was affected by this hailstorm. Windows knocked out, roofs completely destroyed. And so the Methodist Conference, the Northwest Texas Conference, is partnering with a disaster relief organization. They've already gone in. This video is kind of a rallying cry to get people to go there on the 15th, which we've already been by, to go and measure windows. We're at least helping to provide funds and help to replace the windows in a lot of these homes and buildings in town because a lot of the folks there do not have any insurance. And so I'd just like for you to take a moment and watch this video to see some of that damage. And then over the next 2 Sundays, we're going to ask for a special offering This is above and beyond what you normally would give to the church. If you'd like to donate a little bit more, and then we're going to send those funds to this
just
disaster
after
relief
midnight. Okay, so that would be July 1st, going from June 30th to July 1st. We had a cloud build up just west of here, and we had a major hailstorm. I've lived through hailstorms here before. We had a horrible hailstorm in 1979, but nothing to this. Every person in town was affected by this hailstorm. Hoping that enough money is raised that we can help some of the ones that had no insurance or had limited insurance. Let me tell you, there's 100% roofs that are gone. When you start talking roofs, and I talked to several adjusters this week, a normal standard house to tear off paper and reshingle a roof is about $6,000. The Red Cross figured we had just shy of 400 houses. So I just made simple math, did 6,000 times 400. That's $2.4 million. That's just roofs. If you had a window that was on the north side or the west side, it's busted out. So that's not including that. Siding, if you had vinyl siding, it's destroyed. Steel siding is full of dents. Even the metal roofs that are supposed to be a 50-year, you know, or lifetime roof, it's full of holes. The insurance companies are completely saying they're 100% destroyed. So, like I said earlier, I've never seen a hailstorm like this. Golf ball to baseball size hail over the entire portion of Annan.
Okay, so I know if something like that were to happen to our community, we would really appreciate any help that other communities could give to us. And so this is just a way for us to maybe donate a little bit of money to help this community rebuild itself. And so, like I said, we're going to just include it in the regular offering, but if you write a separate check or give cash, if you want to write on there some way, in some way indicate that this is going to Anton, to go to that relief, we would appreciate that, and we're going to do that over the next couple of Sundays, and then in August we'll send our donation to the bank there. You saw the address where you can send monetary donations to them to help them out with that. So are there any other announcements we need to lift up this morning? All right, what joys can we lift up today? What are we happy about? Yes, ma'am. Well, we'll be blessing you on birthday blessings then for having a birthday. That's great. Any other joys to lift up? What, Hannah?
We raised enough money to pay for everything for cheer, the car wash, and just thank everyone for coming and helping support us.
Okay, the junior high cheerleaders had a car wash out here in the parking lot, and on what day was that they had that?
Thursday,
and they had a goal. They needed to raise a certain amount of money to pay for their cheerleading uniforms and camp and everything, and they surpassed their goal. So if you brought your car down or bought something at the bake sale, they want to thank you for your support. Also thank the church for allowing them to have the car wash here. That's just another way we can reach out and help support our community, and so it was really neat to see them down here working hard on Thursday washing lots of cars, and they had a really good turnout for that. So that is a joy. Other joys this morning. Yes, ma'am, Carla. Yes, ma'am.
His draft began before our draft began, that big draft we had, and it didn't end until about 2 weeks ago.
Wow.
And I don't know how much rain he's gotten since then, but he called me to tell me. He said, you know, Carla, I was just desperate, so I prayed to Mom and Dad, told them to ask God to please open up a couple of holes in the bottom of heaven, and my tanks didn't fill up. And he said, you know what happened? Those two tanks filled up. And so then I thought, well, I've got one more tank. And so he said, okay, he did that real well. Then he opened it up over this other tank. And he called me, and he barely got out of our ranch because of the weather. The roads were so muddy. So I turned around, looking into the ranch, and he said, you're not going to believe the majority of that water is falling. Since it's right over that tank, and it is just pouring. That gives me chills, but I just think that's such a cute story that he shared with me.
That is. Praise God. Thanks for that update. Yeah, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Others this morning. Other joys to lift up today. Yes, sir.
My dad, we have him on the prayer list, and the physical therapist, occupational therapist, and everybody has released him. He's good to go.
Very good.
Appreciate the prayers.
You bet. You bet.
Thankful since he's 90 years old.
Well, praise God, and thanks for that update. You bet. Any others this morning?
My dad is doing very well. We moved him from where he lives also. He's now Scott's wife, and they got him fixed up really quick, and he's doing really well.
That's good to hear, John. Thank you. That's an answered prayer, I know, and so praise God for that. Any others this morning? Yes, ma'am.
The same day that Ryan had a birthday, Matthew and Colton celebrated their 10th birthday.
Okay. All right. So it's a... That's a popular day. All right, very good. Other joys this morning?
Cole got moved to Tech.
Okay, so Cole's going to go to Tech. So he's in Lubbock now. That's good.
Jay,
yes, sir.
Georgia got a good report this week in Dallas.
Okay, Georgia got a good doctor's report in Dallas. That's always good to hear. Others this morning? Well, I like hearing all these joys. That's what's wonderful. Becky and I kind of had a joy, the last couple of days. We actually had a house with no kids in it. Well, that happened in I don't know when. Colton went and spent the night with Keith up in Iowa Park, and the girls were at their grandparents for a couple of nights. And so it was just kind of quiet around our house for a day or so. So, you know, that doesn't happen very often. So we considered that a joy, because you don't get to have that very often. Let's take a look at our prayer list this morning. We'll update you on, Mac Pirtle, we've been praying for him with his cancer that has come back, and then he's had another setback. He had a knee replacement a while back, and the knee replacement got infected. And so Friday, they replaced the replacement. And he is in the hospital in Wichita Falls and is hoping to come home tomorrow. He seems to be in fairly good spirits considering all the stuff that's going on with him. But just please keep him in your prayers. Also, I believe Rob is still here at the hospital in Throckmorton. Is that right, Peggy? Trying to get some strength built back up so that he can go home. Hopefully we're done with the antibiotics.
Still no appetite.
Okay, so we need to pray that Rob gets his appetite back. Start eating good and get his strength back so that he can go home from the hospital. Are there any other updates or additions to our prayer list this morning? Yes, ma'am. Okay. Is he on the list here somewhere? I don't think he is.
I'm not sure. I do know that he has like 44 days. I'm not sure exactly the numbers, but about 44 days of treatment.
Okay.
So if anybody is interested in driving him, I know that would be
trying to help.
Okay.
Well, is he here?
He's in, I believe he's in Knox City most of the time.
Then he goes to Abilene?
Okay. So his treatment's in Abilene? All right. So Tim Whitfield for his cancer treatment, and if anybody...
I'm getting my information from 14 years, so it's...
Okay.
Second. So I don't know all the details, but I just know that it's... Now, that'll be a long road.
Chemo's hard enough as it is, but then you're having to drive to Abilene to get it and back after you've had it. That can be tough, so... Yeah, if anybody has the time or knows somebody that might be willing to help give him some transportation, let Corey know, or let Rhonda know. We can try to get that set up. So, yes, ma'am.
Amy Fowler, is still in regional halls with leukemia, and hopefully they're hoping she'll just come home, but she will have to go every day.
Okay, Amy Schroeder lives right over here, two houses over. We need to put her on the prayer list.
Marty had knee surgery this week.
She did, that's right. Mary Ann had some knee surgery. Any others this morning? Okay. Right. Okay. And her name is Nancy? Oh, okay. Nancy Stroud? Okay. Oh, they were asking at Elbert about Barbara Walker. Does anybody know anything?
She's in Jacksboro in a nursing home, and that's where Rebecca lives. And that's about all I want to know.
Okay. Okay. Yes, Briley. Okay. She had a joy. Our dog Ginger is pregnant. So, around the 1st of September, we'll become the proud grandparents of hopefully some very cute little puppies. So, if you're thinking about getting a puppy, just hold off until these are born, because you're not going to find any cuter than these are going to be, I'm sure. So, just start thinking now about homes for those little grand puppies, all right? So, all right. Well, let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer this morning.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a
God, we come to you this day, and we're just thankful that we can come into your house and just fellowship with one another and praise you and sing songs to you and hear your word, Lord. And so we just pray that you would open our hearts and minds to receive the word that you have for us today. May it be a word that would challenge us, renew us, give us strength to go from this place and be your disciples to the world around us. We're so thankful for all the joys that have been lifted up this morning. We're thankful for family. We're thankful for friends. We're thankful we can take names off of our prayer list because of healing and restoration. So we give you the praise. We give you the glory and the thanks. And help us always and everywhere to give you thanks for the good and wonderful gifts that you give us each and every day. Well, Lord, we know there are those who are still hurting. There are those who are still ill. There are still those who need to know that you're there for them right now. And so we pray for them, Lord. We pray that you would be for them, be with them in the way that they need you the most right now, God. That they would feel your touch, that they would feel your presence, and that their families would know that there are people out there praying for them and will be there to help them, Lord. We especially lift up Tim Whitfield for you this morning, and we just ask that you would give him strength as he goes through the chemo, that you would provide transportation for him to and from Abilene, and that you would bring healing into his body from the cancer that he's suffering from. We lift up Amy to you this morning. We pray that you would also bring healing into her body from the leukemia that she has. We just pray for your strength into her. Lord, we pray continued healing for Rob as he's in the hospital today. Lord, we just pray that you would give him an appetite back, that you would help him to get hungry for some solid food so that he can regain his strength and be able to go back home. And we pray for Mary Ann. We pray that you would continue to bring healing to her knee. And Lord, we pray for Nancy Stroud, or as she receives treatment for the spot on her lungs. God, there may be folks that we've thought about and just lifted up in our hearts this morning, and we pray that you would be with them in the way they need you the most right now as well. Lord, we also pray for rain. It's getting dry. So we pray that you would just send your rain in abundance upon this land again to green up the fields and fill up the tanks so that this land can produce for the families and the people who work here and live here. Lord, we pray for this community, for all of those this morning who are waking up without hope, some waking up without a reason to live, some waking up just not unsure of the future. Help us, Lord, to be a light into the darkness for them through our actions and the way we interact with each other each and every day. We pray that you would continue to bring unity to this country, that you would just work through our leaders, that you would give them a desire to seek your direction as they make decisions that affect us all. And God, we pray for our world. We take for granted the fact that we can come in here and worship you, when in so many places, it's against the law. And so we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ who are being persecuted for their faith. We take for granted that we have a safe place to live. But there are places in the world, Lord, where homes have been destroyed by bombs and people are having to live in camps and in tents and very unsanitary conditions. So we pray, Lord, that you would deliver them, that you would stop the violence, Lord. God, when we come to those times in our lives when we're just so overwhelmed, we don't even know what to say, help us remember we can always pray with confidence the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's stand and disregard what's written in the bulletin. Instead, turn to number 370. We sing Victory in Jesus. Please rise.
Amen. You may be seated. Let the little children come up for our children's message this morning.
Whoa, it's just girls today. What do you have, Kate? Thank you. Well, how are y'all today? Good, good. Well, today Brother Jay is going to talk about God's Word. And Psalms 119 tells us that thy word is a light unto our feet and a lamp into our path, right? So, what is this? You know what that is?
Flashlight.
It's a what?
Flashlight.
Yeah. You want to see it? Yeah. It's bright, isn't it? And when would I use this flashlight? What would I use it for? To see in the dark. Is that when you would use it, Kate? Mm-hmm. You're right. John puts this in my car if I go on a trip, in the side of my door. And he says it reminds me it's in there if I need it, by getting a bind. What would you do if you were in the woods and it was dark and you couldn't see where you were walking? Yeah, you'd use a flashlight. So, what about if we're in life, if we get in a dark spot and we don't know what to do? What does God tell us to do?
Get out.
Yeah, if we're in a dark spot, get out. Well, you know what? God tells us how to get out of that, doesn't he? Yeah, he does. And if we'll he gave us an instruction book for life. A manual for life that gives us everything we need to know, not just for dark spots, but when we're in a good spot too. So I want y'all to remember that if ever you're in a dark spot or just for everyday good things, if we'll read the Bible, then God tells us how we should live and what we should do, okay? All right. What? You wore these. Those are so pretty, and they're shiny too, aren't they? I like them. All right, let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, we just thank you for these precious children. We ask, Lord, that we can always shine our lights for them and show them exactly what your word intends for us to do and how to live and how great your love is for us. We pray, Lord, that these children will always turn to you when times are good and when times are bad, Lord. We just give all the glory to you. Amen. Okay, y'all have a great week, okay? All right, bye-bye.
As the children are returning to their seats or going to the nursery, if we could have some ushers gather in the back, we'll take our offering this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you would bless our offering today, that you would help us to give with cheerful hearts, that you would help us to love our neighbors as ourselves, and that you would take these funds and multiply them for your glory here in Throckmorton and all around the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Please rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, as we have journeyed through Psalm 119, we have seen how this psalm reveals to us all of the nuances of God's law and all of those different words for God's law, and that each one of those words has a little bit slightly different meaning, and that they are very, very important for us to understand and know. We've seen how this psalm is a psalm of praise and worship to God. We've seen how this psalm illustrates for us that following God is not just a spiritual exercise, it's also a physical exercise that we do in our physical bodies. We've even seen how we can endure persecution for our faith through this psalm, and the important thing we need to get from that is that we got to know our stuff. If we're going to be ridiculed for our faith, if we're going to be questioned for our faith, we better know the word and we better know it well so that we can defend the faith in the face of persecution. Well, let's see what else we can gain from this psalm and how it can speak to our lives today as we look at Psalm 119, and we'll begin with verse 105 today. Probably one of the most popular scriptures in all of the Bible. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. That's the way I learned it in the old King James version, but it's a wonderful, wonderful verse. I have taken an oath and confirmed it, that I will follow your righteous laws. I have suffered much. Preserve my life, Lord, according to your word. Accept, Lord, the willing praise of my mouth and teach me your laws. Though I constantly take my life in my hands, I will not forget your law. The wicked have set a snare for me, but I have not strayed from your precepts. Your statutes are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. My heart is set on keeping your decrees to the very end. I hate double-minded people, but I love your law. You are my refuge and my shield. I have put my hope in your word. Away from me, you evildoers, that I may keep the commands of my God. Sustain me, my God, according to your promise, and I will live. Do not let my hopes be dashed. Uphold me, and I will be delivered. I will always have regard for your decrees. You reject all who stray from your decrees, for their delusions come to nothing. All the wicked of the earth you discard like dross, and therefore I love your statutes. My flesh trembles in fear of you. I stand in awe of your laws. I have done what is righteous and just. Do not leave me to my oppressors. Ensure your servant's well-being. Do not let the arrogant oppress me. My eyes fail, looking for your salvation, looking for your righteous promise. Deal with your servant according to your love and teach me your decrees. I am your servant. Give me discernment that I may understand your statutes. It is time for you to act, Lord. Your law is being broken. Because I love your commands more than gold, more than pure gold, and because I consider all your precepts right, I hate every wrong path. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, there's a lot of different directions we can go in this section this morning, but I do want to focus on that one verse, because it's something that's not just here in this one verse. It's kind of a theme throughout the entire Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light for my path. And because this verse is poetry intended for singing, remember they sang this. They didn't just quote it, they sang it. We don't need to get into trying to discern some big meaning or distinction between lamp and light and feet and path. This is just a form of Hebrew poetry known as parallelism. And it's a poetical way of making a big point namely that the revelation of God's word is what guides and directs us. Now the word light is one of the most important images for the word of God. Later this psalm goes on to say, the unfolding of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. This is one of dozens of times the word light is used in the Psalms to refer to God's revelation. It's also prominent in the book of Proverbs. Proverbs 6:23 says, these commands are a lamp. This teaching is a light. Excuse me. This theme also runs throughout the rest of the Old Testament as well. However, it's in the New Testament that we see the ultimate revelation of God's light. Because you see, it comes in the form of a person to which even his word must point in eager anticipation. When Mary and Joseph brought Jesus into the temple when he was only 8 days old, they ran into a little old man named Simeon. And Simeon took Jesus in his arms and he prophesied over him, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. Even as an infant, Jesus is declared to be the light of God's revelation. John's gospel makes it even clearer that, first of all, John the Baptist was not the light, but that he came only as a witness to the light. For the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was referring to the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light of God's Word was now being manifest in the flesh through Jesus, the second person of the Trinity. Jesus himself would even declare in his public ministry, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So now we kind of see the full trajectory of Psalm 119. You know, God's word in the Old Testament is light. And then through the New Testament, that light becomes the life of Jesus Christ. It's a pretty amazing picture if you think about it. But I want to focus a little bit more, a little deeper on that verse 105. Have you ever really sat down and meditated on that? Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. What's that really saying to us? Now, I don't know about you, but I like to know where I'm going, don't you? I remember one time when I was about a sixth grader, I was at church camp, and I went to church camp at Cedar Canyon up in the Panhandle. It's down in part of the Paladura Canyon. It's a really beautiful place, and there was a tradition at that camp that on the last morning of camp, anybody that wanted to, one of the counselors would take you on a hike early, early in the morning to watch the sunrise. And you had to walk about a mile and a half through this canyon down along the creek and cross over the creek a couple of times and get on this kind of a bluff where you could look to the east and watch the sun rise up over the canyon. It was a really, really beautiful experience. And so I wanted to do that. So my friend and I got up super early in the morning. It's still pitch black dark outside. We go outside and we meet up with the other kids and the counselors that are going to guide us. And I realized as we were fixing to start walking that I'd forgotten my flashlight. My friend had one of those Coleman lanterns, those battery-powered ones, you know, little Coleman lanterns. I don't know if you've ever tried to walk anywhere by lantern light, but you can't see very far in front of you when you have a lamp, especially one of those little dinky battery-powered lanterns. About all you could see was the next two steps, if you were lucky. And so this is how we hiked to the sunrise. Looking down the whole time, making sure we weren't going to trip on something and just making sure, you know, every once in a while we'd kind of glance up and try to see the other little flashlights to make sure we were following on the right path and everything. But it got frustrating after a while. Because, like most of you, I wanted to see where we were going. I wanted to see the end of the road, the destination, but I couldn't. It was impossible. It was pitch black dark outside, and all I could see was the next two steps and my friend, you know, right there with me. That's all I could see. I had to trust that our counselor knew the way and that he was guiding us down the right path and that we would end up in this place where we could see this beautiful sunrise. Well, of course we did. You know, it wasn't like he was going to lead us astray or anything. But it's still, it's frustrating when you can't see where you're going, isn't it? I mean, how many of us would just go out and jump in the car and just take off down the highway and just drive with no destination in mind? I'm just going to go till I run out of gas. You know, that's not logical. I heard a story one time about two sailors who were on shore leave in New Orleans. And they had to be back at the boat at, you know, like 7 o'clock the next morning, but they were out having fun like all the sailors do when they come in on leave, and they went to some bars there on the Bourbon Street and everything in New Orleans, and they got a little too intoxicated, and they realized that they weren't going to be able to drive themselves back. And so in desperation, they found this old Cajun guy to give them a ride. And they got in the back seat, and the Cajun guy started driving, and they fell asleep in the back seat. Well, they woke up. It was broad daylight outside. And they were just flying down the highway. They looked at their watch. It was 10 o'clock in the morning. And they knew they were AWOL. They were in big time trouble. And they looked around and they were just flying down this four-lane highway. And they looked at that Cajun guy and they said, "Where are we going?" His eyes don't know, but we're making good time. Can you imagine the thoughts that went through their heads? You know, if they left at 5 o'clock in the morning from the bar and it's 10 o'clock, there's no telling where they were by that time if he's flying down the highway. It's unsettling. It's not fun. We like to know where we're going because we like control, don't we? We like to be in control. I mean, when we're thinking about our lives, especially, we like to think that we have a direction and we're going to go there. We're going to get a good education. We're going to stay out of trouble with the law. We're going to find a career that's rewarding and hopefully provide a good retirement. We make plans. We make dreams about the future. And yet we serve a God who basically says, "I'm just going to provide you enough light for the next step or two. My word is a light unto your feet. And a lamp into your path. It doesn't shine out 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road." And that's frustrating for us because we know God. We know that He sees all of time. We know He can see the big picture of our life and what it's going to be like 5 years, 10 years, 20 years down the road, especially if we choose to follow Him and live our lives for Him. He's got it all worked out because you were raised hearing that. God has a plan for your life, right? And we know He can see it all, but why won't He show it to us? Why won't He give us that big picture so we can know where we're going? I think there may be a few reasons why He does it that way. I think God may understand or know that, quite honestly, we couldn't handle seeing what our lives would be like 20 years from now. We just wouldn't be prepared to handle it. I mean, I know I would have freaked out if God had shown me where I would be at 47 when I was 27. I'd have been sitting there going, right. Sure, because I had no desire to be a pastor when I was 27 years old. I was talking to some people out at Elbert, and there's the guy that's just moved out there. He lived out there, grew up out there, Kyle McCarson. Y'all know Kyle, right? Okay, you know what he's doing now for a living? He's teaching third grade math. He's going to coach volleyball next year. All right? Now tell me, what would he have probably thought 10 years ago if God had shown him that that's where he was going to be 10 years from now? Right. Okay? We probably couldn't handle it. We probably just couldn't handle it. So I think that's one reason why he just shows us one step at a time. But I think a reason even more important than that is that it has to do with our faith. If he just revealed it all to us at once in a dream or in a vision, well, there wouldn't be any reason to trust him, would there? We could just say, hey, great, there's my life. And then we could just start working to make it happen. But if we're only given one step at a time, then we have to have faith in God to show us the next step, and the next step, and the next. It requires us to be in a relationship with Him, to deepen that bond we have with Him so that we're in tune with Him and so that we won't go astray and go down the wrong path. It's all about trusting our future to someone else. And that requires a lot of faith, doesn't it? I think another reason why he does it this way is because if we are constantly looking ahead, then we miss out on what's going on right now. If we could see 10 years down the road, we might miss out on today, this moment, this day, Sunday. What's God going to bless you with today? What's God going to show you today? How's God going to use you today? If we could see 5 years down the road, we wouldn't be thinking about today. We'd be thinking about the next day or the next day or the next day, and we would miss out. We might miss out on some really awesome blessings that God might have for us right now today. It's really why it's so awesome that we have Jesus with us. You know, the psalmist, when he wrote this, he couldn't have imagined being in the kind of relationship with God that we have the opportunity to be in. You know, God loved the people back then, and he interacted with them back then, but there were limits to it. There were boundaries. There were really strict boundaries to how he interacted with people back then. And to think that the God of the universe, the God who spoke and created everything with a word, could live inside of you through the Holy Spirit. Man, that would have been overwhelming to the psalmist. But we get that. We get that, don't we? And I think sometimes we even take that for granted, don't we? I mean, it's just like having clean water and plenty of food on our table and a roof over our head. Oh, we have Jesus. We've always had Jesus. He's just always been there. But really think about that sometime. Really try to wrap your mind around the concept that the God of the universe, who is huge and magnificent and people couldn't even see him face to face without dying, knows your name. And wants to have a relationship with you and wants to live inside of you through the Holy Spirit. Man, that's huge. That's big. And because of that, because of he's there with us and he's living within us, that gives us even more direction. That gives us even more reason to trust him and let him guide us step by step through life. So I guess the question for us this morning is this. Are you trusting the light of the world to guide your feet today? Or are you setting your own course and hoping God's going to bless it? That's the temptation. You know, hey God, I got all these plans. I want to do this, 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 and this. Retire when I'm 60. Live here. Build a house. Do all this stuff. Could you bless that for me? Thank you. Instead of saying, okay, God, I don't know where we're going, but I trust you to guide me step by step by step. Are you content with moving through life one step at a time, taking what comes, and making the most of each moment, each day, each hour? Or are you trying to see so far down the road that you're missing those divine moments with God, with family, with friends, with neighbors, right now? Those are the questions. My prayer for you this morning is that may you lay your plans down at the feet of Jesus this morning. And like He did, say, not my will, but yours be done. Let's pray. God, it's hard. It's hard to let you guide and take control because we want to know where we're going. And sometimes it can be so hard because sometimes it just doesn't seem like we're going anywhere. And sometimes it seems like we might be going the wrong way. And so we confess right off the bat to you this morning, it's hard to trust you with our lives. But that's what you're calling us to do. That if we want fulfillment, if we want peace, if we want joy in our lives, then we have to trust you with it. And we have to be willing to say, yes, Lord, I'll trust you. I'll trust you to take me down the right path to the place you've called me to be. And I'll be content with that. So help us, Lord. Help us live life to the fullest in the moment that we're in right now, instead of worrying so much about what's going to come tomorrow. Help us seek you and love you and enjoy life, knowing that you have what's best for us already planned out. And Father, if we find ourselves right now, maybe some of us are on a wrong path. Maybe some of us have drifted away and are going in a way that is not of you. I pray, Lord, that you would gently redirect us and get us back on the right path. Get us back on the path we need to go on. Show us, give us wisdom to know which way to turn so that you can guide us to your plan. You have so many blessings for us if we'll just look for them and seek them and take them. Help us to see, Lord. Help us to trust. Because your word is a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our path. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Candy gave me an option just a while ago of doing an audible, or as our son-in-law, Coach Cope, would say, check, check, check. So we've kind of changed at the last song, and in going with Jay's message, we'll stand and sing, Thy Word. Words will be provided on the screen, and I'll save next song that we had picked out for next Sunday. Please rise. When I feel alone.
May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit and to the honor and glory of God the Father, help us to know that it's never too late to get back on the right path. And let God guide you and direct you each and every step of the way. So give us the strength and the desire to let Him do just that. Amen.